Okay. Sorry about that. Always amazing that he makes these talks and but yeah, when we look at everything that's happening in the context of surveillance, it's a real challenge. Everybody sees the sweep of history that we've dealt with. Everybody sees Snowden getting more indications that there's a sound issue. If that's the case, everybody just makes a noise about trying to see what I can do on my end to fix that. But anyway, let's talk just briefly about surveillance, what's in it, where it's going, and all of those things. Because I know we've got questions on I think when you look at the context of combating digital surveillance, you have to understand how it is that it's performed. Now, one of the things that motivated me to come forward was to work behind that as right with the U.S. intelligence services, see the gap distance between what the public understood, the laws of my country and your country and Canada's country, to me. Sort of apply to our understanding of our common and collective rights as well as the individual person for that, and also what our capabilities were and how those were applied. And it's a gigantic gulf between them where I saw a breakdown that was really not about surveillance. And this is what people don't understand. People think of 2013 as surveillance story, but it was really a democracy story. It was how you can have a nominally democratic government, and we like to think of it as a free society. And yet, when you insert enough secrecy into that, it becomes kind of a shelter from accountability. And so, policymakers and eventually officials begin to become divorced from the public. They begin to become divorced from any kind of public direction. And what happens when you have a long enough period of this? As they start to go, well, mission first. It's whatever we believe we are tasked to do. And the public can't actually give us any feedback in that, so we get stuck on very much a bureaucratic state circle practice rather than public certain institution. They just continue in this circle, continue in this circle, continue in this circle, until the public becomes not the master, rather the subject of it. And when I think about this in the context of what's happening with technological progress, and in that context of surveillance, we see that the progress of technology has changed us. The status quo of where governments targeted people, groups, largely on a very specific level, because they had to use expensive, they had to put people on the streets to follow you, to see how they're meeting protests. Cafes, teams in cars, teams on foot, teams at banks and telephones, teams at school. Now, this is all automated, so a single officer, someone like myself, could come in for work in the morning in Hawaii and just give entire reports of everything that's behind everywhere, phone, every text message they send, every website, URL that they enter. And it would just be that reportable format. Therefore, you're the morning because it ran over night against all of these service providers and all of these interception points around the world. And this is what I mentioned, these sort of alerting and reconnaissance of people's activities that the state is interested in. Now, in the context of law, traditionally in the United States and in most countries, this would be considered an investigation on the basis of some kind of warrant where they would go to court, they would show they had some cause to interfere with someone's right to privacy. The court would make the decision on an individualized basis that there were grounds for suspicion such that you could authorize this kind of intrusion. But now that's all gone because it seems too slow at a time of terrorism. We can't wait for the process. And so because of this, individual officers are allowed to authorize these kind of investigations, these kind of intrusions on what in the United States we call a mere reasonable, articulable suspicion of wrongdoing rather than probable cause. I'm trying to find a cause for wrongdoing suspicion. And so we go after this, right? This can be a passive collection between desert crosses and the internet, right? Can we just help ourselves? So the UK really is the frontiers of where this is happening the most. And you go, look, we're going to tap everything. We're going to be in the country, we're going to be out of the country, we're going to be collecting, we're going to sit, we're going to do it all. And I think just yesterday, actually, or just a few days ago, thanks to the efforts of the mission team partners, the government was actually acknowledging that this sort of communication was even intercepting the private emails of the police themselves. Hearing this kind of controversy. That's actually passive collection. No one ever has to lift a finger for that to occur. It just happens as things move across the internet when they are not encrypted, right? Which is to say, they are electronically made visible across this hostile path. Since 2013, this status quo has been removed as technologists, as engineers, as activists, they pressure companies. And to change this status quo, where networks are protected by default, meaning they encrypt communications as they're in transit, this has become a big point of friction. Governments would prefer that we sort of recover moments. But there is a question really here on the policy level, what is better served? If we are all open for exploitation, because this increases the government's investment efficiency, or is it better if we are all protected, even from foreign adversaries, even from criminals, even from spies, even if this means the government's working harder to do what they want to do? Then there's the second side of this. Instead of passive collection as data moves, as data transits the internet, to where data is at rest, where your communications, which as they happen largely today, don't actually take place between you and the person that you're talking to. They happen between you and Facebook, and that provides a copy of it to the person you're talking to, or you and Gmail, and that gives a copy of it to the person that you're talking to. And every time these transactions occur, these service providers, they keep a record of it. And they form these great silos, sort of databases of who of everything you've done, everything you've typed into those search bars, everything you've clicked on, everything you've liked. And with the just lowest standards of evidence, they're happy to hand this over to governments. Unfortunately, for those of you who are not American citizens, the standards for foreign nations, information for any U.S. intelligence company, for people's data to be accessed by the U.S. intelligence community, are extremely low. We have actually multiple that are applied to the entire capitalist economy. I know nobody cares that much about the details of how this happens, but just broadly, right? What's happened is that the laws have been structured in such a way that the U.S. government can make representations to foreign courts, to foreign politicians, and go, we have the laws. They say, we won't do this, we won't look at you, we won't scrutinize you unless you're up to no good. You just simply have to trust us that they're being followed. In private, in secret, because this information is not shared even with our closest partners. We can look at whatever we want under our own domestic laws because those rules are not truly binding. One of the big protestations that the U.S.'s intelligence partners make before European courts is, well, under Obama, in the wake of the scandal, the U.S. instituted new sort of rules under an executive order. This is just basically a napkin. President signs and says, here's the way we're going to do this now. These things can be changed at any time. They can be changed in secret. I think President Donald Trump has said he doesn't really care what President Obama says, he said it was his own rule. setting in line for all 10 conferences. So I'm not convinced that even the light rules that we got in response to 2013 are not it's a system of beliefs that is this happens, we realize the dangers are real, but that's why we do it. And so, questions? So, initially, just a couple of questions from Edward, and then we'll go as soon as possible to the audience. As you finished, you were talking about shared systems of belief and the importance of activists coming together and the importance of sticking to those principles. In some senses, you were an unusual observer in terms of your own political position. As a young man, you were, I think it's probably safe to say, positioned on the political right. You wanted to serve your country. You saw yourself as an American patriot. You now sit with liberal activists. You now sit in Moscow as the guest of the Russian government and have become something of the darling of the political left. How has your own personal politics shifted over this period, if at all? And do you still see yourself as an American patriot? Well, we're losing the answer.
So this is kind of a complicated thing. I think it has presumptions that don't entirely hold true. I would never have identified myself as a member of the political right, neither would I have identified myself as a member of the left. Now, most people, particularly in the world, always see themselves in this partisan framework of the left at the right, whereas I've always been more concerned with the north south libertarian. Between those two positions, I would think I'm very much sort of in the center, but not in the open system. It's sort of the left here and the right there. But what I have seen as I've looked at the space of activism, and I've sort of learned and worked quite closely with the American Civil Liberties Union in the United States, which is not a partisan organization. They have some reputation being a pretty strong one. On the left, is that in terms of effectiveness, unfortunately, the shall we say, more conservative of the rights movement groups, the ones that are less effective. And I think that's because people on the left, politically, we come from a traditional sense of the left politically, understand much more because of struggles from labor and things like that. Whereas a lot of people on the right, they begin and they envision. And I think, it's wonderful, it's valid, it's great work for people making individual contribution, but we have to understand when we're talking about the global scale, we're talking about the national scale, we're talking about the global scale. We have to work, it has to be more classes. And this is one of the interesting things about when we talk about patriotism. My version of patriotism, I think, is very different than yours. This is something that's developed. Most people, when they think about patriotism in the context of intelligence community, so GCHQ, maybe on the Senate, they think about keeping the head down, they think about keeping their mouths shut, they think about just following orders, they think that's what patriotism is. But I think of patriotism as loyalty to the country rather than to the state. I think of it to the people. Rather than to groups. And this is something that has very much been lost in this new wave of authoritarian nationalism. And I think it's very much dangerous. Because what is it that you're really fighting for, if not people? If you're fighting for this abstract construct of rule, that's all very well, but so long as you have a benevolent rule of force, use not systems of control, but rather methods of governance, right? And that's self-collective governance. And this is one of the big challenges. Is, when I was sitting behind my desk, and then I saw everybody in this was looking one way, and I saw these indications, I saw this evidence that we were going beyond the law, beyond the Constitution, we were violating human rights, not just domestically, but internationally. I asked myself, is this right? And I asked them if this was right. And the funny thing that a lot of people, you know, they're surprised by is the people I work with really know it wasn't right. But then it gets back down to the level of the individual. And they realized if I said something about it, if they said something about it, I would get you in trouble, hurt your career, end your career, and that would be it. So why do it? It's beyond our pay grade, and it wouldn't help us, and it probably wouldn't make a difference. Because the government would simply jail us or our access, and that's the end of the story. But what happens in the old world? And this gets back to what I said at the beginning. Which is progress. And ultimately, for me, it wasn't so much about what benefit me, and as you said, I ended up stuck in Russia, and it's not my choice to be here. I applied for asylum. I think I entered 28 countries of language in Europe. But if nobody does it, things will happen. And I can't fix it. I can't say that all I know, you know, this was going to solve the problem. But it's not up to me to solve the problem. It's not up to any of us to solve the problem. It's up to us to help. Right? All we have to do is lay down that one word. All we have to do is say that one thing. All we have to do is flag attention. But to care enough, to strive enough, to do enough, that others are aware, and they can hear, and they can decide, is this person crazy? Or is that actually eminently rational? And should I help them? We add all of our collective labor, we add all of our collective effort together, we can't fix the problem. And I would say, basically, that's the beginning and the end of my politics, since I put me on the left or the right. I don't really even think about it, because I don't think it matters. My politics are going to the problem.
Brings us rather neatly to the case of Catherine Gunn. Certainly her motivations were very similar to your own. She was sitting in GCHQ in 2003, just before the outbreak of the war in Iraq, and she saw details of an operation to spy on the United Nations. She felt that that was crossing a red line, and she alone did something about it. Now, what's retrospectively fascinating is how little we knew at the time about what was going on as the British global public. What she demonstrated was that the British and American governments were prepared to spy on their allies, and it has now become clear, thanks to what you did, that those governments are prepared to spy on all of us. Our understanding at the time was hugely out of date, and I'm sure that some of the questions we're about to get, you will be able to enlighten us on whether or not our understanding now is out of date. But one thing that your revelations did, and Catherine Gunn's revelations did, is they allowed us to hold politicians to account, allowed us to catch them out in a lie. So you caught the American establishment out in a lie about the scale of surveillance, and Catherine caught the British government out in, and the American government out in lies about why we were going to war. What I'm keen to know is whether catching people out in lies is now possible. In the kind of post-truth environment, in the populist environment, where certain of our senior politicians don't mind being caught out in lies, what is the role of the journalists? What is the role of the activists?
This is very much the question of our political world. I think what we see in an emergent debate, in the old days, it was very easy, or rather relatively easy, for the public to keep secret. You had broadcasters who were very limited number, you had newspapers who were very high level structure with a few editors, right? And if you had the golden rulings, you could kill sort of do what the George Bush administration did under the run-up to the Senate or the war rooms, where mass surveillance programs that I would be talking about, so until 2013, first taken root just before the re-election. The New York Times had the story that the United States government had created a domestic mass surveillance system, flagrant violation of the Constitution. And they added the anytime Snowden, which was decided by a historically slow election. But they didn't run it before the election because those were still the old days. And the Bush administration picked up the phone. They called Bill Kimber, the executive editor of the New York Times, and they said, please don't run this. If you do, you have blood on your hands. You know, terrorists are going to run wild, they're going to die, and that's going to be on you. This is a national security concern. And Bill Kimber, who is, I would think, kind of a sort of discredit, said, okay, sure. Bush got reelected, was sort of actually run until 2005, 2006. And at that point, it was really too late to stop. So when we talk about accountability, I mean, what does that actually mean? I think what we have is greater discipline in political terms. And this is because what happened then is a little bit harder to believe. There's simply more newspapers. There's simply a greater ability to publish. So sources, you know, they can go tweet this out. They can go to Instagram. They can go, maybe not so much anymore, unfortunately. They can go to 1,000 newspapers in 1,000 jurisdictions and get the story out. And when I speak of emerging behavior, I think what we see from politicians is a systemic response to a lack of appetite for accountability. It's like, well, if we can no longer suppress the truth, what we have to do is find the mechanisms for defending it. And so this is how we seem to end up with these politicians who are so bad on a personal and professional level that their misdeeds can't really harm them because the public seems to have taken into account that they are the worst people on earth. And yet, somehow that appeals to a certain percentage of the electorate, right? Because they go, well, we know who this person is. Or this person will be just as bad to our enemies. Kind of a better the devil you know. But I think what we're seeing is a reaffirmation of the players to the rules in the game of the greatest war on the system. Basically, the public has won a massive coup. In terms of visibility into these systemic misdeeds. And now we have these, this sort of ruling class that is responding to it and trying to find ways to operate. And what we have today is we have the public trying to come to terms with this and come up with the outcome that they very much have not yet done. But I think we will do what we are seeing right now is the public going, okay. This is new, and the public broadly is trying to decide if you like this or not. And there's a part of you going, we do very much like this. These people are saying that you privately think the ugly, darker side of the human character. But I think what they have in mind for us, and I think we're seeing in not so many years, are the consequences of that. Again, no action without reaction. And as the consequences of putting the worst people on earth in charge of our sort of levers of state become clear, to affect the person. Honestly, it's kind of blatant that these people spoke the unthinkable. But realize that that is not, shall we say, the best way to further their own interests. So long as the dark side of people's human nature actually benefits from the personal darkness of these politicians. I think this is the whole main statement. And this is where what you're seeing is kind of the essential goodness of people. If you think we are a dark creature, if you think that things are constantly getting worse rather than better, you have enormous reason to fear. And I think a lot of people feel that. However, look on that broader scene, as I do, I think we have a vulnerability to this kind of darkness, particularly in moments of fear. But I think we are quite rational creatures, and I think we are quite social creatures. But I think these things intersect over time. We are better than our families. And I think that's actually going to show us in our own discourse that we are better.
Thank you very much. I think we're going to open to the audience. It's pretty easy to find this for the answer. So, yes, talking of the essential goodness of people, we're all sort of good people. And our first question today is from Alyssa Machugina. Alyssa, I believe you have a mic coming to you. Sorry, I really can't see the comedy unfolding in front of you. So, you now have the mic, please.
As a young person, I see many of my peers apathetically giving away their privacy for modernist excuse, prioritizing convenience and fashion over human rights. For a generation that has grown up with such priorities, how can we ever hope for change?
I see this. It's a great question for giving this out to them. I'm from the nature of I think for a lot of this, it's not quite fair. Yeah, because to us, it's clear that that's the best thing. To them, it's an average person. I don't think we're because the average person, when they use Facebook, when they use Instagram, when they use Twitter, when they're on everything, I just don't know what those are for us. They don't see themselves as making this great trade. They see themselves as living. They see themselves as participating in ordinary society, doing ordinary things that ordinary people do. And the funny thing is that they're doing that. We shouldn't expect people to have to bring all these things to the other church or even all these things to the next place and realize that they're being created. The most extraordinary. By the most powerful and most factions of the world have the most sophisticated sort of political strategies, some of the best individuals that are making hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars per year to create these cognitive dark patterns, to convince people, ordinary people, are not specialists, and it's fine. Yes, they can have the little data, yes, they can have some records, yes, they can do this. It's just a target, it's just a device, it's not religious, it's not really dangerous, it's not really harmful. And then it doesn't really seem like a trade. It is, I think, corporate predation on an essential human desire to collaborate, to communicate, to share. That is the thing that we should judge. And I think we should judge that both in interpretive terms, but I think we should also judge that in practical terms. And I think that's what we're seeing. We do not have, in the current moment, a political group in our religious cultures to actually recognize this kind of behavior for what it is, which is really an attack on our world. Again, you mentioned before, I'm not a cop, right? And I say that with love. There's a lot of things out there. I come very much from the American philosophy tradition. And if I'm looking at this, and I'm saying that some of these countries, need to be regulated out of intestines, that means something. And, there are people in my country, there are people from that kind of libertarian concern, who would think that that is kind of blasphemy, it's kind of mercy. But we don't allow this in many other states, right? There's a reason we have medications under control, under prescription, right? There's a reason that we have limitations on ways we can look. There's limitations on the kind of contracts that you can enter into, right? You can't volunteer yourself into slavery, even if you want to, if you're well compensated. Because we recognize there are power relationships that can be abusive. We understand that there are resource relationships, but which mean that the average person, the common person, the young person, cannot meaningfully consent to certain kind of relationships and exchanges. And this, unfortunately, is what we see being taken advantage of today. And the laws simply haven't caught up to the fact that a technological corporation can indenture entire populations into servitude to the corporate rather than to the individual and the public. And I think this is the kind of thing that we don't even see meaningful discussion about today, because it does strike people. It's just radical. It's just extreme to say that companies simply can't do this. Again, when I look at this dynamic, when I look at how it's affecting young people, when I look at how it's affecting public, our perception of what is normal, I don't think so much what are the costs of regulation as what are the costs of doing nothing about this status quo to perpetuate and become entrenched. It begins to become a that is influenced less by our domestic politics, less by our communities, than by companies that decide what every person, every year reads when they look at the phone. I mean, they plan the notifications, interesting. They decide what appears on your timeline. They decide what appears in your email, right? They may technologically say, we're starting to make through policies that we don't use these tools. We never do that. But the raw technological capacity is absolutely unmatched, and it's actually and when we see that kind of power remain in so few hands, that should very much influence.
Thank you very much. We next have a question from Sam Howell.
GCHQ has considered plans for enabling law enforcement and other officials to become hidden third parties in encrypted communications in apps like Signal and WhatsApp. This is known as the Ghost Proposal. They claim this is only hypothetical. Can we trust this claim, or do you think they already have the capability and intention?
So this is a great question. For those that are into the question, I spoke briefly about giving power communications with something too simple. There's two general rules. The data comes to me, right? As it crosses the internet, you call up your telecommunications service providers. Think about when you send a message, how does it get from where you are? How does it get from your phone to someone else's phone? How does it get from the request from your computer, your laptop, to Facebook.com, right? It crosses a huge technological infrastructure of routers and servers. It's basically enormous fabric of little point-to-point links from you to your local municipality, from your municipality to an upstream municipality to large city to a sort of undersea fiber optic link connection to other countries. And it's just lines, right? And it's wires buried underground, wires strewn across, telephone poles, everything everywhere. Is that what if you attempt at different points of connection to say headquarters in your country's local communication service, to one of your domestic ones or whatever, you can decrypt messages, which they send to Facebook, which you might never know about Wi-Fi. Facebook, Ting, Google, Ting, and then they give you some information to the public. As that model falls out of favor, you want the divorce to be where it comes from. Encrypts the message directly to your friends. Now, Facebook doesn't have a copy. Google doesn't have a copy. Only the messages were intended for have copies of the keys that might be reading these messages. Governments don't want it. We don't really want these. We've become accustomed to the complete models everywhere. In our territories, and everyone outside of our territories, we can see communications. So, yes, you may agree. Sorry, they say how do we restore the status quo where we can see everything everywhere? And what they come up with is they want, what if we go to the companies that make the tools to send these things, right? Secure messaging equipment of a Facebook, the secure messaging equipment of a Google, and go, we won't let you basically operate in our jurisdiction. We'll try to arrest you, or we'll try to coerce you, unless you change your software such that every time your phone sends a communication, the software program used to send that communication to your friend's phone also encrypts a copy of the same message, right? Encryption just means locking messages with keys, right, that are only shared by these parties. If you encrypt it with an additional key that's held by the government, right? And it may even transmit a copy of your message to whoever locked that key. The government then goes, we're not against encryption. We love encryption. You're encrypting these messages to me. But they're encrypting it to themselves. It is the equivalent of saying, write a letter, to your grandmother, to your office, to someone anywhere, without photocopying that letter, right, and putting it in a locked box that the government puts into, right, and literally mailing it to government in this locked box. The post would say, please take this, British government, to the U.S. government, to win. The technological difficulty of implementing this kind of proposal is not high, but it's extraordinarily dangerous, it's extraordinarily insecure. Because now the government has a key into every communication in every private life, and the value of that key becomes very high. We've seen just in the last few years, no less than the NSA, and this is not even related to it, no less than the NSA itself, which is supposed to be the highest security, top secret organization in the world, with enormous technical capabilities, hacks, and everybody lost their digital motion. It was stolen by someone they still to this day have not identified. It was published openly online and everybody stole for digital currencies. And then these tools were used, they were co-opted by criminal networks in a way that led to a global ransom attack, which is some kind of malicious software. And it brought hospitals across the UK from the National Health Service in Cornwall. It took the Maersk shipping company offline, which is a massive fraction of international shipping trades. It took hospitals in the United States offline. It took a car company, I think, a car factory in France offline. And these are tools created by the US government for hacking adversaries that they could not control. That a company and that a country that cannot control its digital arsenal with a practically unlimited budget is going to attack the key to every communication recorded. Now, imagine it's the little, forgive me for saying so, 1998 UK movement. I'm trying to understand. Now, imagine it's the Moroccan movement, the Libyan movement, the Chinese movement, the Russian movement, right? Everyone that you know trying to do this. It is a dangerous proposal that will not improve public safety very much.
Thank you very much. We don't have much time left, unfortunately. I'll so lots and lots of questions. I'm going to take one more question from the floor. I'm going to ingeniously try and summarize all the other questions. The next question is from Charlotte Warburg, but is going to be asked by Fernando Dorme.
Hi, thanks. As the UK prepares to leave the EU, what do you consider to be the key measures our government should take to safeguard or possibly improve our digital rights post-Brexit?
Before you answer that, I'm just going to summarise the rest of the... A lot of the questions... Okay, so the next question was about facial recognition. We've got a question about Facebook's role in the Cambridge Analytica scam, and a question about the US Huawei ban. And each of those questions, it seems to me, are asking you not to talk about how dreadful things are becoming, but how we might do something about it. So clearly the Brexit question is about what we do about our digital rights, but actually the other questions are also typically as activist questions, what do we do? Thank you.
Thank you. The Assange and all my agents on today, is how about human rights act? You know, it's appalling to me, and honestly, incomprehensible. Like one of the big arguments for why the UK wanted to leave the EU is on the animal market and the human rights act on the UK in a way of higher courts of review. These courts are not particularly interesting, not particularly basic. How do you create a kind of structure in a system of requirements for those requirements in the context of government that has a diminishing respect for the individual and for the public? I think that's a very challenging thing, and this is one of the things that people get a little nervous when I talk about. This is one of the places where the great problems that we're facing with the UK can actually help us as we make the right to the solution. We have relied on relentlessly throughout the history of activism, human rights, and human progress, and social politics, because we have all to do. And law was really the only way we could try to bind the most powerful from us, but also worst problems to a common ground. The problem with law is that it's not universally enforceable in the way that we'd like to theoretically believe that it is. Everyone in this room understands cases of official abuses where that person is facing a law without accountability. I think when we talk about the context of the Iraq war, and we look at the position we're talking about in the total layer, it's clear that we don't have the kind of accountability that this is the solution, right? Does it always have to? Can we use systems of government, right, of science and math and technology to create sort of method guarantees of certain measures, right? And it's not going to jump off the table. And see you soon. Sorry, that was to say, math is not going to jump off the table in the same way. This is the same thing for law. What is the law? How does law protect you? The law is black letters on page, right? The ink can't protect your rights. The law cannot protect society. Rather, it is society that protects the law. A society that gets the law enforced, a society that gets the law many, and if we fail to do that, the law becomes an influence, the law becomes a gift, the law becomes a sidestep, and these officials should do it right. This is one of the sort of promises of things, techniques like encryption, and this is why it's so alarms governments, and trade systems that provide mathematical guarantees of human rights, that message becomes private unless the key is not protected, unless the key is lost, unless the key is stolen. But the government cannot simply say, we get the key. The government has to get the key for tenants. It has changed the game in a way the government cannot really overcome, unless there's certain things that we talk about here, but they actually try to compromise. The tool vendors, right, the people who do this, are going to talk about increasingly accessible applications, talk about methods of problem, things that you should answer. That kind of influence will be out of their reach. But it's not enough, right? Saying what technology can solve our problems is too bad. It's not an idea. We've seen technology can cause our problems. But what if we don't let it change? How can we disappear? Our activism? How can we collect the action together so that rather than relying exclusively on technology, exclusively on protest, on activism, on any of these methods, they serve as important checks and balances, right? So that they are mutually reinforcing. I think this is kind of the direction we have to move into, because, yeah, look, when the new is not going to be when the British people what do you do? Things go back to normal. Yourself, you have the family, you have the community, you have the movement, and we have to start over. We have to reconnect, we have to redesign, we have to respond. Because whenever there are these pendulum swings in the way the system works, as we saw earlier this time, is it accountability or is it visibility? Yes, now we know our government's role. We don't know everything. There are still confusing secrecy and amazing historic ones. But we know more. And it's harder for them to suppress the truth. And so what they're doing now is trying to improve our ability to respond to that truth. And right now they're succeeding. And it's just the game. But we can change the game again. And I think that's what this is about. I think that's what we're doing. I think that's what we're talking. I think that's why we're discussing, we're coordinating. Is we're trying to go, what's our next move? And please, just remember, that's not something I can sum up in a long form, but I'm not going to do. When you are thinking, you are doing, you are thinking, you are sharing, you are acting, you are caring, right? And that's the first step in the path to care. And you've already passed that threshold, you're here. So now the next step is to move. And while I don't know what's going to happen next, ladies and gentlemen, there are very few groups in the world that I would say trust you. Up to their instincts and their judgment, their demonstrated